VR eventually. And the one thing that surprised me the most was that the biggest price tag in the entire thing came out to be the graphics cards, which is not a surprise to you guys that have done gaming and built gaming rigs. But for me, that was a big surprise, because to do true VR on an Oculus Rift, you needed a card that was about $600 to $800. And that gets you thinking, because really, and with the advent of things like the Google Cardboard, I was really excited, because I thought, you know, VR is going to be for everyone. It's going to be here right now because people are getting it for $20. But when it's not really possible when the content creation platforms that you have are expensive and are sort of bulky and really, really unwieldy, and there really isn't standard out there yet. Which is the reason, I guess, why we don't see a lot of VR YouTube channels or VR movies or just general indie VR stuff. So that's something we were trying to fix in the NUS Hack and Roll very recently. And the thing that we built was just a way of making VR more accessible. It was doing what Google Glass did to VR, except for the other side. So it was a very simple but more powerful idea, because what we were doing was we were using any two cameras. We created an online platform that would use any two cameras, and you'd see the video later, that would combine them and create a VR stream in real time. So any person with two cameras, or a person with a friend and two smartphones among them, would be able to start a VR stream. And that VR stream could be viewed by people with Google Glasses, Oculus Rifts. The system would automatically adapt to the kind of system, the kind of device that you were viewing it on. So what we really aimed to do was make sure that anyone could produce VR content, because that was something that really we asked around, and not a lot of people were able to do it. The best we heard was some sort of screen mashing that was really, really super weird. And that, I guess, is the eventual reason that we don't see anything other than VR games these days. But we managed to do it, and what we built was called the Oculus Drift. We built a sort of car with a little smartphone app that would drive it around. But the advantage of that was that we had two cameras on there, and people would actually see things as though they were in the car. And we built it because it was our first time at a hackathon. We wanted to put something together. But the minute it started working, our booth immediately crowded up. People wanted to drive this thing everywhere. It broke like 3 times, which really did piss us off. And the idea that I'm really trying to get at here is that VR needs to be more accessible. If this is more of a very ghetto system of building things together, but there needs to be a system out there whereby any person can create VR content. That's what we were trying to do, and we managed to do it. We managed to create a lot of VR content that people enjoyed, and they used it for a long time. So you don't really have any of the problems with 3D out there. You know, people never complained about headaches, even though it was all clumped together at the last time. That's something that we were really afraid of, but just never happened. VR, I think, really is the future, and I think it would do for something for movies that color did way back in the 80s and the 70s. I mean, I think a long time later, we're all going to look back and say, you know, how do we even watch things in 2D? You know, because real life is 3D. And the same way that we see right now, how do they watch things in black and white? Why wouldn't everyone just want to watch it in color? Like, isn't that the natural way of seeing things? So just to conclude, this is a really small one. I'm not very prolific with my projects. I just want to show you the video that we made for Hack and Roll, which I think will demonstrate some of the ideas that we were trying to.
100 years ago, this is how we would watch things. All black and white. You can't really see the colors popping behind you. You can't see the greens, the yellows, the reds, the purples. How about now? See, this is how we view things today. You can see the colors, but you're not really human, are you? Why not? See, as of Hack and Roll 2015, this is how we view things today, and this is how you will view them tomorrow.
It's not simple. So we managed to get everyone in the audience, or at least all the judges, because that's what really matters, VR glasses, and we got them to view it in true VR, and they really did experience it. We didn't do the whole 3D gimmick of having things jump out at them, even though it was suggested. So the idea was, it's very simple, what I've described to you, two simple phones, different models, we put them together in a car, anything, just tape them together, put them in your pocket, it works. You've got a VR live stream going on. I think this should really be the future out there, not in this way, but it should really be the way that people create VR content. I'm really excited to see, because I own a Google Glass and we're getting a bunch of Oculus Rifts for the hackerspace soon. VR content that doesn't require us spending $800 on a car. Blew all my money on the video cards. So that's what we did. And I was really excited when Jill called me up and he asked me to talk about it. Apparently he'd seen it at Hack and Roll, because VR really needs to get out there. Or it's in danger of ending up like 3D. Thank you.